It is simply called The Shootout, a race inviting Canada's top drivers to run all out for a $150,000 prize fund. It brings Canada's top drivers from the East against Canada's top Western competitors, running on Canada's toughest track, Mosport Park. Last year was an action-packed, all-out war to be continued today. The Players Limited GM Motorsports Series Shootout on TSN.
Welcome to Mosport Park near Toronto. Hello, everyone. I'm Pierre Houde. Well, we have looped the loop, as we say. We've opened this exciting 1992 season right here in Mosport with Kenny Wilden's victory. Well, Kenny has the championship wrapped up now. And today we are not talking points in the standings. We are talking big money as we are about to show you this 1992 shootout. And to know more about that, here are Jim Paulson and Pat Gonzalez.
Welcome to our final event in the 1992 Players Limited GM Motorsports Series event, the shootout at Mosport Park. And Jim Paulson, you've been to many of these before. The drivers have completed their Eastern and Western series, and now they come together for this big shootout.
Obviously, by the look of that damage, some of them have not had great luck in the qualifying rounds. In fact, people like Norman Boyer, who finished second in Halifax, ends up at the back of this grid today. But what is interesting, Pat, is the changes that are happening in shootout up front here.
Well, the East drivers have dominated over the years. In fact, the only West driver to make it to the podium was Frank Allers. But looking at qualifying, I think there may be a changing of the guard here in the shootout because two of the fastest three drivers are from the Western Series.
Yeah, we're not just talking young Lions here. I mean, look, at young Jeff Lapcevich looked so strong in the qualifying round, but we're talking the West are really coming on strong here. And, boy, if you give these guys another year or two, I would think they'd be running on pretty equal ground. They really have become competitive.
Well, Wade Lee and Trevor Siebert are right up there along with Kenny Wilden, who was again the fastest man as he has been much of 1992. But Jim, the atmosphere here around the paddock at Mosport, a bit of a bittersweet one. This is the final race in the series that has a very illustrious 7-year history. But I think for some of the drivers, they're going to look back with a lot of fond memories. But I think all the focus, all the attention is on this one big race with an awful lot of prize money.
I don't know. What happens with that green flag, Pat? I get a feeling you're right. Even the bittersweet is going to disappear. And I'll bet you any money, we end up everyone just focusing again on straight race action. And I think this one is going to be very competitive today.
Well, the drivers from the East and the West are ready to do battle here in the Players Limited GM Motorsports Series Shootout. So now let's take a look at the starting grid.
The man from Saint-Agathe, Quebec, Norman Boyer, crashed his car in practice, got it fixed. He'll return at the very back of this grid.
Another driver returning after a crash, Duncan Anderson, wrecked his car in Calgary a few races ago, but has returned for the shootout.
Ken Leslie from the West competed in a few Eastern events, including Halifax last week. He's back.
Ron Schell, he has experience on the circuit, likes the speed here, and he should have a good run.
Another Eastern driver with lots of track time at Mosport is the driver of the number 77 Camaro, Paul Mackey.
Running a limited number of events this year is Mike Hart, a regular endurance driver. Mike is very much at home on this circuit.
Number 6 Firebird of Todd Nickel out of St. Albert, Alberta, a Western regular. He's ready to attack the East.
An Eastern Firebird of Robert Stein will start from the 24th position.
The 92 Eastern Rookie of the Year, Shane Grossman, will start 23rd, our youngest competitor today.
Another veteran of this circuit is Neil Jamieson. Neil loves Mosport and the high-speed challenge this circuit provides.
Out of St. Albert, Alberta, the black number 7 Firebird of Carl Haar, a steady Western competitor with hopes of a top 10 run today.
Sean Grossman has had a great season in 92 and would like to impress here on his home track.
Marcus Mahelchin, a native of Edmonton, and his Steelcraft Doors Firebird, a young star waiting to shine today.
Paul Duckworth began 92 with a spectacular spin and a top 10 finish here at Mosport.
Black Labiche, Alberta's Ken Staples in the Molly Black Gold Machine with a good qualifying run. A veteran driver, he's ready.
Eastern driver Terry Betts has had a podium finish at Cayuga, but is still looking for his first victory.
DJ Scranton had a strong qualifying effort, and this member of the French Connection looking for an aggressive race at Mosport.
Craig Priddle missed the Eastern final and returns to Mosport confident in his ability behind the wheel of the Camaro.
Chris Davies is back for Bank 10 Mackey Moving. He ran well in the Eastern final, now faces this faster circuit of Mosport.
Bill Drossos, the young Western driver who sat on the pole on the Calgary Oval, has had a great year.
Tony Morris, a veteran of these shootouts, knows the importance of money and pride. He wants this final shootout.
Kevin Dowler ran well in the 91 shootout and ran well here at Mosport.
The 92 Western champion Frank Yallers ran well, and all his previous shootout appearances should do well today.
John Cadman still looks for his first victory in 92. He led the last race here, but was victimized by Moss Corner.
Our 91 Eastern champion Rob Fellows had that spectacular crash last year. Rob hopes it'll be a Fellows win in 92.
Kenny Wilden has done it all this year with 6 of 8 victories and many new records. He is the Sunoco fastest Eastern driver, posting a new track record.
Trevor Siebert, defending Western champion, appeared twice in the Calgary Oval, finished first and second. He's the Mohawk Western fastest qualifier.
On the second row, another Western driver, Wade Lee, who ran the entire Western series and selected Eastern events.
Jeff Lapcevich has really impressed everyone in 92 with his abilities and has a great starting position today.
Peter Cohen wasn't sure he would compete at the beginning of this season, but he's done well, including a victory at Trois-Rivières.
Richard Spinard is on the pole. He won on the circuit 3 times in 91, comes off a big win in Halifax last week.
John Cadman concentrating on the task ahead. There is Trevor Siebert among our top Western drivers. Jeff Lapcevich strapping up inside his Camaro. Peter Cohen looking for his second win to go along with his tremendous victory at Trois-Rivières. And of course, Richard Spinard, a man who has been here from the very start of the season, about to start his very last Players Limited GM Motorsport Series event. The cars are rolling at Mosport. We're just moments away from the start.
The Players Limited GM Motorsport Series on TSN is brought to you by GM Motorsport and Players Limited. Welcome back. It's TSN's coverage of the final Players Limited GM Motorsport Series shootout from Mosport Park. And field looking pretty good order as they come through the back of the course, getting set for that start, Pat. And boy, the excitement is building around this course today.
Well, Jim, an awful lot of cash on the line as we look at the Western final point standings.
Ellers out of top, 421 points. Just ahead of Kevin Dollar at 409. Here's the Eastern standings. Kenny Wilden taking up with 788 points. John Cadman Jr. ending up second, 656. 4 names with the rest, of course, in those top 5 that we really got to keep an eye on here today as we get set for this start.
Well, let's take a look at this track here at Mosport. Off the start, you go downhill through turn number 1 in 4th gear. Drivers will use every inch of the racetrack right out to that outside speed curb. Then it's acceleration up over the hill and into turn 2. One of the most exhilarating corners on this racetrack, just a little bit off camber. You tuck tight in on the inside and drift right to the outside of the racetrack. Quickly to the left side of the track to make your way into turn number 3. You go through here in 3rd gear and at about 150 kilometers per hour. Then onto the short chute as you begin your run down towards turn 4. This is the turn under the Players Bridge. Flat out as you go down there, and then it's uphill into the tightest, slowest, but most difficult corner on the track, Moss Corner, through 5A, now through 5B. Very important to get through here quickly and with a lot of momentum, because you'll carry that momentum all the way up the Andretti back straightaway. Drivers will shift to about 3rd gear at this point, then catch 4th gear as they work their way through what is turns 6 and 7 on the racetrack, no more than minor bends in this back straightaway, then reaching 200 kilometers an hour, then about 215, topped out at the crest of the hill, braking carefully into turn 8, carrying tremendous speed into turn 9, the left-hander. This is the S's here at Mosport. Then downshifting to 3rd gear, through into corner 10, And very important as well to carry speed out of this final turn and back onto the front straightaway to complete a lap. 3.957 kilometers, a minute and 39 seconds on the clock.
25 laps of that they'll have to run today. Richard Spinard in charge. Look at that, a little tapping, in fact, as they come through and get the green flag, and this race is underway. This is the shootout in 92.
Gorgeous day here at Mosport. The field charges in a turn one. Spinard has the lead. There you can see three wide as they run through turn one. Frank Allers right in the middle of a big scrap back there. One of the cars just about running off the racetrack. Spinard, your leader, as they run through that oil-dry powder, really stirring up a big cloud of dust. That a result of a blown engine from a Player's Atlantic car earlier on the weekend, but it's Spinard leading them through turn three. There you can see this tremendous field winding its way through turn three here at Mosport. Richard Spinard, your leader in that black Motormaster Camaro. Then it is Jeff Lapcevich in the yellow Mr. Loop car. There is Kenny Wilden as he tries to move up into Moss Corner. It is Spinard, Lapcevich, Cohen, followed by Wade Lee. Oh, a little bit of contact there as Bill Drossos, number 27, got into it just about right off the racetrack, but did a nice job of gathering it back up. They had on the Mario Andretti back straightaway, Spinard, your leader, Lapcevich holding on a second. Then it is Cohen, Peter Cohen in third, and then Wade Lee fourth.
Boy, look how aggressive young Jeff Lapcevich is. Again, in memory of his brother Joe, he's running the yellow equipment. He has a go at our race leader, Spinard, and Jeff may get by. No, Spinard gives him a little elbow, hangs out of the lead, coming through the S's. And will they hold that way coming back into the back straight? I tell you, this is already exciting up front, and Jeff is not giving up here.
Lapcevich putting out a great charge. Very difficult to make that pass up to the outside as we look at the field coming through to complete lap one. But Richard Spinard continues to lead it. Jeff Lapcevich in second on the inside. That is Wade Lee side by side with Peter Cohen. The two STP sponsored cars running door handle to door handle. And right behind him, we ride along with Kenny Wilden in the number 17 Pringle Slick 50 car. There is Peter Cohen. Oh, and Wade Lee and Cohen just about got into it right in front of Kenny Wilden. Some incredible action here in the early going.
I tell you, if Kenny Wilden is wise, he may just watch this for another segment of this track anyway. No point in attacking this war that is happening directly in front of him. But the STP team members from East and West, and this is Wade Lee that we're looking at, by the way, number 79 out of the West, are holding Kenny up just a little bit right here. I don't think he wants to have a go at them. No, not even in corner five.
Peter Cohen, number 46, holds that third place spot. Wade Lee right behind him. And then it is Kenny Wilden in the fifth place spot. We've got a spin in Moss Corner. Didier Scranton off the racetrack on the inside. Scranton trying to get the car back onto the racetrack, but he'll lose several positions. Spinard, 42, still your leader. Jeff Lapcevich in the yellow car running in the second place spot. And again, Lapcevich will take a look to the outside in that Mr. Lube, Tim Horton's Camaro, but Richard Spinard will lead them back through the S's.
Look out, guys. Kenny Wilden is beginning to come on here as well. I tell you, Kenny has gained a notch or two. He's sitting in fourth overall, but this is excitement up front. Young Jeff Lapcevich taking on the veteran Spinard and not letting him run away at all.
Down into turn one, Richard Spinard by about 5-6 car lengths over Jeff Lapcevich. Then we've got that little bit of a gap back to Peter Cohen and then Kenny Wilden. And now we ride along with Trevor Siebert, who was running in eighth. Ahead of him, a great battle going on for fifth, sixth, and seventh. Oh, number one, Rob Fellows being tapped by Wade Lee, 79. Fellows gets through on the inside and just ahead, John Cadman Jr. Here's Trevor Siebert. He'll try to pass 79 Wade Lee on the inside as they go through turn three, but Lee will have nothing to do with that move from the Western driver Trevor Siebert. Some incredibly close action going on here in the early going. Some of these drivers taking big chances. There's Peter Cohen in third, but now feeling the pressure from Kenny Wilden.
And just back of this gang is young Kevin Dowler, who's got his thoughts on the driver's line at Mosport today. Kevin?
This track is a fast track, and to go fast, you must exit turns really clean. Turn 5B especially is the takeoff or the launching pad for the straightaway. If you don't get a good clean run out of there, you're going to lose, you know, 6, 7, 8 kilometers an hour down the back straightaway. Might not sound like a lot, but when our cars are so equal, it is really a lot.
Well, Kevin over the years has managed to spend a little bit of time at this facility, and that's the way he would attack it today. But boy, look at this attack, in fact, Pat.
Kenny Wilden, number 17, at the end of the back straightaway. Oh, Wilden just about sideways coming through turn 9. Kenny up into third now in that Pringle Slick 50 red Camaro. Right on his rear bumper, though, is Peter Cohen, the leader. Spinard followed by Lapsevich. Wilden now up into third. Oh,
Bill
big Grossos. Spin.
Yep, he spun out number 27, Bill Grossos, one of our top Western competitors. In fact, running well earlier. Here's a replay on that bat.
Well, it looks as though Chris Davies may have tapped Bill Grossos in the back as he was coming on the pit straightaway. Grossos spins the car around. Davies has to go up onto the grass to get around, and then he finally is able to get the car straightened around before heading for that pit wall. Spinard, 42, in that black Motormaster Camaro, your leader. Lapsevich in second. Then it is Kenny Wilden, followed by Peter Cohen in fourth as they come into the chute, and now up into that fifth place position, moving up quickly, is the 71 car of John Cadman. So Cadman is one of the drivers on the move. Number one, Rob Fellows, currently holding on to the sixth place position. So on the back straightaway, you look at the front running group. Spinard, followed by Lapsevich. Then it is Kenny Wilden, Peter Cohen, John Cadman in the second of the Motormaster Camaros, and then just a little bit of a gap to the next group that involves Rob Fellows along with Trevor Siebert.
Now, in most of our major race events, you would expect them to kind of settle down just a little beyond the start in some of these mid-race laps, but this is shootout time, Pat. We're talking an awful lot of money that they're competing for, so I think we're going to see a sprint tempo throughout this entire event. Certainly, Spinard is not backing off. He can't. Young Jeff Lapsevich has got him going at full tilt here, and Spinard is not going to rest for a moment.
Well, Jim, there's no need to think about the next race because there simply isn't one here. This is a flat-out, as you said, all-out sprint. You've got all that prize money on the line. None of these drivers try to protect any kind of a points position in the standings. This is just run as fast as you can, and Spinard right now, the fastest driver so far. He leads the back into turn 3. Then it's Lapsevich, but look at Kenny Wilden. He is starting to put on a charge. He is reeling in both Spinard and Lapsevich, and he is bringing Peter Cohen and John Cadman along with him. So very shortly, this lead group will consist not of just Spinard and Lapsevich, but 5 cars. Richard Spinard back into Moss Corner. 6, maybe 7 car lengths. Back to Jeff Lapsevich, who closes as they come out of 5B and head up the back straightaway.
Boy, all you have to do is listen in this race, Pat, and you know the guys are putting these good years to work today. Here it is, the front 5. Mind you, Rob Fellows is not far off that front 5, and he'll be doing what he can, but I think our front 5 are actually tightening up, led by Kenny Wilden here in the third spot, so they are beginning to catch up to young Jeff Lapsevich, who's right on Spinard.
We've got a little bit of a gap back to that next group. Rob Fellows in 6th, Siebert along with Wade Lee. And now here is Peter Cohen as he will try that outside line through turn 8. There's Cadman. But still, Richard Spinard at the point position out of turn 10. And now we ride along with Richard Spinard, looking back to the Mr. Loop, Tim Hortons, yellow Camaro of Jeff Lapsevich. And what a year it's been for Jeff Lapsevich. He had that incredible run at Cayuga Speedway and then has come back here to have an outstanding effort in qualifying, and right now running right with the veteran Spinard sitting in that second place position. There you can see that oil dry. Most of it has been blown off, but the driver's very, very tentative at times running through that long oil slick where the corner workers have done a nice job of cleaning it up. But again, the drivers maybe a little more cautious that time through turn 2. But it's still Spinard, your leader, Lapsevich, Wilden, and then Peter Cohen running in that fourth place spot.
And look out, Jeff, it's a much closer Kenny Wilden as they come back down to the hairpin. And Spinard gets through it properly. Jeff holds on like glue. Kenny, though, is up even tighter. And here we are after 6 laps down to 25. We'll be right back. Don't go away. Welcome back. It's the Players Limited GM Motorsports Series Shootout at Mosport on TSN. Richard Spinard is leading at this stage.
The racing has been nothing but outstanding. Here goes Lapcevich trying to get around Richard Spinard at the top of the hill. Again, Lapcevich will look to the outside as they go through turn eight, but no, again, Spinard will hold him off. That outside line off the end of the back straightaway just has not worked for Jeff Lapcevich, and that'll bring Kenny Wilden a little bit closer. In fact, Lapcevich, big slide. Here goes Wilden on the inside. Yes, Kenny Wilden up into the second place spot. Peter Cohen right behind him as Lapcevich made that mistake going through the S's, and Wilden will go through in a second. He'll take Peter Cohen with him as he takes over third. So Jeff Lapcevich, that one little miscue, cost him two positions out on the racetrack.
Now, let's go back just split seconds in race history here in car with Kenny Wilden and look at the Sony coverage on how this pass was set up one more time, Pat.
Well, you see Jeff Lapcevich trying to go around Spinard on the outside. Kenny Wilden takes advantage of that mistake as Lapcevich just does not have the right line going through turn nine. He doesn't carry enough speed into 10. Wilden is able to slip through on the inside in a second, and Peter Cohen, running right in the tire tracks of Kenny Wilden, also comes through into that third place position. So two positions down for Jeff Lapcevich, but he's still very much in this race, running in this lead pack.
Kenny Wilden drops a tire off here, he drops a tire off there, but he's not losing any spot at all. He's very cool, very precise, total focus here today, and a nice second position. Now he's got a reel in Richard Spinard. Today on Infotech, let's look at the conservation of the racing equipment, saving the car. In the Players Limited GM Motorsports Series, it's true that to finish first, you have to finish.
Well, there's certainly a need to conserve these cars. I call it car management is what I call it. And these cars really teach you to really manage what you've got there, because you're going to lose your tires, you're going to lose your brakes. The other thing that you're going to lose is your consistency and your mental attitude. If you lose your tires and your brakes, what's going to happen is you're going to have to use a lot more adrenaline, a lot more of yourself to make the car work properly. And so everything starts to fade.
Now, strategy is very important in driving one of these cars.
Well, what we try to do is, I don't think you ever win a race in the green flag. So if you can stay up with the front runners, and even if you're fifth or sixth, like I said earlier on, do not panic. Just stay there with them. You usually find the first, second, and third guy. If the first guy doesn't get away, they will use their equipment up. And many's the race over the last, since 86, that I've actually got guys and passed them going in because I've conserved my equipment. Sometimes I've made the same mistake by sitting back too far, and the first group get away and you can never catch up to them again. But basically, these stock cars, you must conserve the equipment, and especially the tires and brakes. If you let the brakes go, you're dead. If the tires go, you're dead. You're absolute toast. You can't get it back.
Conservation, it's a key to winning a Players GM race.
Well, to conserve these 3,400-pound GM street cars, the number one thing is consistency. I go out and I challenge the track and the other competitors real hard at the beginning of the event, a little mid-race stint, and hard at the end. You know, I give it a break about one-third of the way into the race just to let myself and the car catch up to either the track or the competitors in front, and then we just continue on.
Well, the cars are marvelous, but you want to save them as much as you can in the midst of these race events, Pat, and I don't know if there's much conservation going on in front of you, though.
Well, I don't know how much of these cars any of these drivers are saving. They are really pushing the pace. We've seen some incredible action already as Spinard will lead that front-running quartet over the crest of the hill and back into the S's here at Mosport. There is your leader, Spinard. Kenny Wilden, the Eastern champion in that red Pringle Slick 50 car in second, then Peter Cohen, and then Jeff Lapcevich. The number one car of Rob Fellows holding out of that fifth place position as he'll lead that next group out of turn 10 and back onto the start finish straightaway. But it's been Richard Spinard who has been in command, but he's got some company as they head down into turn one.
Kenny Wilden looking to the inside one more time, takes a little different line. Now, as they come up to the top of two, we're gonna find that the oil dry dust is still not gone. They're still kicking up a little bit of a flurry through there, Pat, but not as much of a problem as it was earlier.
Spinard, then Wilden, of course, that was the story in Toronto this year at the Molson Indy Players Limited GM Motorsports Series event when these two drivers literally had a war on that street circuit along Lakeshore Boulevard and through the exhibition grounds. And here at Mosport, it is Spinard and Wilden running in that order, just about three car lengths separating the pair. Good job here by Peter Cohen, who has certainly had some great runs in 1992, and Jeff Lapcevich sitting back in fourth in that yellow Camaro. They're out of turn 5B, and again, up the back straightaway, Wilden getting a good drive coming out. He's tucked right behind Spinard now as we ride along with Richard Spinard, looking back to the man who is in hot pursuit, Kenny Wilden.
You know, I think maybe Cohen is playing the best game of the ball here. He's just showing his maturity one more time. I guess the victory this year maybe helped him. If he's wise, maybe just keep a very close eye on these two as we again keep our eye. Oh, look at this. Kenny Wilden does make a move to the one side. Spinard has got to remain alert here because I think Kenny's about to jump.
While Kenny Wilden looking to the inside, but the veteran Spinard protecting that inside line as they come into turn 10 and now back onto the pit straightaway. But again, a car length, maybe a car length and a half separating these two drivers, but Richard Spinard, your leader up front. Kenny Wilden holding out of that second place position, and now these two drivers starting to open up a little bit of ground on Peter Cohen. Richard Spinard, your race leader, Kenny Wilden in second, Peter Cohen still running in the third place spot, Jeff Lapcevich is fourth, Rob Fellows rounds out the top five.
And look out, there's one or two of our competitors having a bit of a problem here in Mosport, so already these race leaders are dealing with some back markers. They got to be careful in those passing procedures. Look at Kenny, right up and under, literally, the bumper of Richard Spinard.
And Spinard using all of the racetrack and then some, getting his car right up out of those speed curbings. Under the Players' Bridge, Spinard stretching it out now, two, three car lengths. Again, Kenny Wilden under braking up in a Moss corner will park it right on the rear bumper of Spinard's Motormaster Camaro. There you see, time and time again, Wilden is just getting a tremendous drive coming out of turn 5B. And Peter Cohen now has made up a little bit of ground, Lapcevich, and now we've got a pretty good scrap back there for fifth as Trevor Siebert now has closed on Rob Fellows. But the focus of our attention, this race for the lead between Spinard and Kenny Wilden, and now we ride along with Kenny Wilden as he tries the outside move on Richard Spinard that Lapcevich tried a couple of times. He can't make it work either. Spinard will hold out of the lead as they head for turn nine.
I think what Kenny Wilden is trying to do here is force an error out of Spinard. I don't think that's an easy chore at any time. He's watching Richard's braking procedure here very carefully. Gets him over on the curbing. Now, Kenny thinks maybe on the front straight I'll have a go.
Kenny takes a look down to the inside. Spinard says no, thank you, and slams the door shut. Wilden trying to carry that speed out of turn 10 on the pit straightaway and carry that momentum through turn one. Not able to get around Richard Spinard, who continues to hold his black and red Motormaster Camaro up front. There you can see the drivers and Spinard as well using every little bit of this racetrack. Peter Cohen still holding third and very much in this race, as is the fourth place driver, Jeff Lapcevich, in that yellow Mr. Lube Tim Horton's Camaro.
Again, Kenny Wilden has a look to the inside. He'll stay to the inside as they come back down into corner number five. Could this be the key here? Kenny pokes his nose. No, no, look at this. 81. Neil Jamison goes astray in the midst of all this race activity. Neil will try to get that straightened out, of course, and get back in the race here if he can, Pat.
Neil Jamison spinning in turn one and throwing some dirt out of the racetrack as we look at this lead battle on the back straightaway. And look at how close Kenny Wilden is to Richard Spinard. Firstly, right on top of his rear bumper, and Wilden now will move to the left side of the racetrack as they go in at turn eight. But no, Spinard just shuts the door, and Wilden will have to again tuck in. Wilden trying everything he can to get around Richard Spinard, but Spinard wanting to hang on as long as he can here to the lead. Out of turn 10, they move onto the start-finish straightaway right up onto that speed curb. And there is Wilden again looking on the inside. No, Spinard will hold his line and lead him out of turn one. There's that dirt that Jamison threw up onto the racetrack when he spun moments ago. And Spinard and Wilden hitting it for the first time. Richard Spinard down to the bottom of turn two, ahead of Kenny Wilden. Peter Cohen runs third, and Jeff Lapcevich holds that fourth place spot.
Now look out, this racing group are coming up on more of the back markers. The most dramatic moves in this track are being made by our second place man, number 17, Kenny Wilden. Look at this, a frantic wave from Paul Duckworth saying, no, no, guys, go on by that way. They do, they take it on the inside of the track. So Paul is no problem, and again, they come down the chute into corner five. What'll Wilden do here?
Kenny Wilden again looking on the inside of Spinard, but Richard right now driving what is really a defensive race. But there goes Wilden right up alongside, and the two drivers now will run out of turn five, seeing a little bit of bumping on the back straightaway. Wilden right out onto the grass, reminiscent of the war they had in Toronto at the Molson Indy. Spinard and Wilden just virtually hammering at each other up the back straightaway, and that, of course, has allowed Peter Cohen to pull right in behind. Wilden again putting a couple of wheels off, and on the inside, Wilden will go through into the lead. Spinard into second, and Cohen runs third. Incredible action, Jim.
Actually, the big decision that Cohen had to make here is, who do I follow? Do I follow Spinard? Oh, look at this. Spinard gets right into Wilden. Wilden a little sideways. Spinard rubs and brushes him one more time. No, Wilden will not give up. He wants to lead this definitely. He does. Into the front straight. Now look at Jeff Lapcevich make a move on Cohen. No, he backs off.
This race turning into a bit of a demolition derby involving our front runners, but for the moment, they are separated as Spinard takes a look on the inside going through turn two, and with all that action up front, all of a sudden Rob Fellows has caught this group along with Trevor Siebert, so what had been a quartet battling up front has now become a superb six-way fight for the lead. But 17, Kenny Wilden, your race leader. Spinard again trying to pull up alongside in second. Cohen is third, followed by Lapcevich, Fellows, and then Trevor Siebert. Kenny Wilden, your leader, as they go under the bridge.
Spinard gets up with him. They get sideways. Then Wilden pulls out again. Cool, Mr. Cohen, sitting in third spot, says, oh, no, let's let these guys resolve it. You know what? He can't maintain that thought, though, for long, because now he's got Rob Fellows right up on his bumper, along with Jeff Lapcevich, Trevor Siebert. Look at it. Wade Lee isn't even that far away. I tell you, this is an exciting battle, but Kenny Wilden still leads it.
While our freight train of Camaros heads up the back straightaway, Kenny Wilden running up front, Spinard, Cohen, and then the rest of the group.
Now, on this week's Chronos, we examine the cost of racing in the Players Limited GM Motorsport Series. There's no denying that motor racing is a very expensive sport. The Players Limited GM Motorsport Series always tried to offer a competition where the best driver, rather than the biggest budget, would be able to win. That was the original formula that attracted these 40-car grids of Camaros and Firebirds, but as the series and the teams have matured, inevitably, costs have risen. The cost of a crew to prepare and maintain the equipment. The necessary spare parts and tools necessary to keep the cars competitive. The tires, while regular production Goodyears are another cost. And the regular equipment to keep any racing team moving. And there are always the unforeseen expenses and costs in spare parts and, well, of course, bodywork.
Some of the major costs that people don't realize in racing are the not just the cars and the parts themselves, but the accommodations and the transportation are the major cost components that I've found this year. Fortunately, we have transportation equipment, but still it's very expensive, and therefore we've teamed up with some other people to transport their vehicles around also.
And of course, these GM products need regular care and maintenance.
Most commonly is brake pads, rotors, and lots of tires. So other than that, basically fairly digestible what we spend on the cars. It's not too bad.
Budgets for the race teams can vary from small to large, but the rules keep all the cars equal.
We've been fortunate this year. This series with the cars as full body cars and so competitive, there's a lot of body contact. We've had sponsorship from an auto body, BJ Custom Finishes. We've had sponsorship from Redline Oil in California. We've had sponsorship from Performance Racing News here in Canada and Canadian National Leasing. And they've all helped to offset the cost, because it's quite an expensive undertaking to do it properly, to keep fresh tires on the car and good parts in the car at all times. So we've been fairly successful as the year has progressed in adding sponsorship to help cover the cost, because we're certainly far from being one of the highly budgeted teams, but I've been able to generate enough sponsorship interest and sponsorship revenue that has covered most of the cost of running this year.
Generally, a well-prepared medium-sized team can be very cost-effective and competitive.
It doesn't take a lot of work on the cars compared to, let's say, a Trans Am car or something like that, but it is a good tribute that the lower budget guy can come through sometimes. I was there at Toronto. If I hadn't been hit, I'm pretty sure I would have been in the top three. And then again, Montreal, but that was really driver fatigue. But other than that, I really think that this series is very good for this sort of the lower budgeted team to come out in the clinch.
Kenny Weldon, number 17, continues to lead our $150,000 shootout here at Mosport. As he comes up to the start-finish line, Weldon just a couple of car lengths ahead of Richard Spinard and Peter Cohen, followed by Jeff Lapcevich in the number 32 yellow Camaro, and then Rob Fellows in car number one rounds out the top five. The only Western driver able to run here with these Eastern fast guys is number 33, Trevor Siebert. He is in sixth, the last car in this front-running group as they work their way through turn three.
Once again, Pat, they're coming up on traffic as well, which might be a factor. Kenny Weldon, though, has already proven, in fact, he did in Halifax, how capably he can carve his way through any of those traffic situations, so it may not affect him at all, but I'll tell you, all you need is one little item to affect you. When you got a Spinard that close on you, you don't want to bobble it for a second. Now, it could happen here in corner five. Will the train maintain? Well, so far it does, coming out of 5B, and again, back up onto the Andretti straightaway. Here's where they'll get some speed.
While Kenny Weldon has been very good on his exit out of Moss Corner, and he carries that speed all the way up this Andretti straightaway, and now, in fact, he's opened up three, maybe four car lengths on Richard Spinard. Spinard will have to keep it close. If Weldon can get away, then Spinard will not have the advantage of the draft as they peel off here in a turn eight. It's still Weldon leading, Spinard holding out a second, Cohen having a great run in third, Lapcevich, Rob Fellows, and then Trevor Siebert.
Here's Kenny Weldon, flings that rear out almost again, but boy, he has got the car set up beautifully for Mosport today. Takes that tight line again on the inside, heading down the back straight, and 12 laps are done. Kenny Weldon, who's dominated this year, looking good in the shootout. We'll be right back. Welcome back. It's the $150,000 Players Limited GM Motorsports Shootout on TSN. Kenny Weldon has got the lead now.
Well, Kenny Weldon, who totally dominated the Players Limited GM Motorsports Series East this year, winning the championship, is trying to take the lion's share of that $150,000 as he works through turn eight. Spinard, Cohen, there is Jeff Lapcevich, and now Rob Fellows moves up to challenge 33. Trevor Siebert still hanging right in there. So as we look at the East-West confrontation here in the shootout, this front-running group of six consisting of five of our top East drivers, and only Trevor Siebert has been able to run on the pace. But it's Kenny Weldon, your leader up front, and there goes Rob Fellows on the inside of Lapcevich. He'll take over the fourth place spot. Trevor Siebert also going through on the inside. Jeff getting out onto the grass, and he'll drop back into sixth.
To me, that's an awesome sight to sit here and look at Rob Fellows, the reigning champion of this series. Trevor Siebert, the reigning champion of the series. Yes, both have lost their titles this year. They want this shootout, maybe just to regain at least a little bit of pride back.
Well, there's Siebert up into the fifth place spot. Fellows just ahead of him. Of course, Rob, who I'm sure is not happy with the results here in 1992, would like to end the season with perhaps a win. But right now, he's going to have to get around this man, Kenny Weldon, as he works through turn 5B, beginning his run up the back straightaway.
And at the halfway point in the shootout, it's Kenny Weldon, the Goodyear mid-race leader. The Goodyear Eagles are Kenny's for this last run of the year.
And right now, Kenny Wilden with a lead that is expanding over Richard Spinard as we look at the rundown through the entire field here at the halfway point. There's Trevor Siebert, so things starting to settle in just a little bit. Wilden has opened up about 10, 12 car lengths on Richard Spinard, and Kenny now trying to run away with this shootout. Spinard trying to keep it close. Cohen followed by Fellows, Siebert, and then the number 32 car of Jeff Lapcevich. As we continue with our rundown of the entire field, Todd Nickel. There is the man in 20th, our Eastern Rookie of the Year, Shane Grossman, one of our top Western drivers, Carl Haar. But up front, it is Kenny Wilden in that red number 17, Pringles Slick 50 Camaro. And Wilden, as we said, who had just a marvelous season, would like to put the icing on the cake here with a win in the shootout. It would be his very first shootout win ever.
To me, interesting to note, Terry Betts back in 13th place of all things. Tony Morris here sitting in 11th. And John Cadman Jr., 10th overall. Some of those front runners really not having a good time in this shootout, Pat.
Well, it is as we look at the cars come in at turn four, watching those drivers negotiate turn two. It's still got to be a little bit slippery there from the oil dry that was put down much earlier this weekend, a result of a blown motor in one of our players' Atlantic sessions. And here is Kenny Wilden right now pretty much by himself. Spinard has got some catching up to do. Richard still within contact of Wilden, but he doesn't want to let him get any further ahead. Otherwise, he may just end any chance of catching Wilden. A little bit further back, Wade Lee there in the STP Camaro. He runs in seventh as many of the cars have already been lapped. There's Duncan Anderson. He runs a lap down. Now we see the Motormaster Camaro, Frank Allers, number 12. He is eighth. Then Craig Priddle, and then it is 35. Kevin Dowler running in 10th. There is Terry Betts. A disappointing run for Terry. He is in 11th. And right behind him, the Sony car of Mike Hart.
Today on Profile, we look at Mike Hart's Sony teammates, Paul Duckworth. In 1991, Paul entered the series as a rookie, learning how to drive these challenging cars. But in 92, he's back with confidence.
I think really the major difference has been the confidence factor. Last year, although I had a lot of time in the car, I struggled to be comfortable in the car. But this year, I've really felt like I was in command of the car, as if the car and myself were working as a team. And that is really the way to go. And there's been a couple of drivers that run real close to the front, specifically Kenny Wilden, has helped me a great deal in my progress, trying to pass on to me the little minor tips that can make the difference between running 10th and running 5th.
Paul's skills have flourished in this extremely competitive environment.
I really think the key to the competitiveness of the series is definitely the respect that other drivers have for one another. It's a case where, okay, yes, you're visibly faster than me, but, you know, we're working with the same car and we're working towards a common goal. We all want to run competitively and we all want to be near the front. And the guys at the front are certainly up for the challenge of our competition, so they're always willing to give us a hand.
Paul is pursuing his college career. He's trying to balance it against a busy racing schedule.
It certainly is difficult balancing your time. I suppose prioritizing is essential. You have to decide, am I going to race or am I going to commit myself to school? Really, at this point, I'm totally committed to school, trying to get my education, and racing is something that I do primarily as a hobby, but I would one day like to make a career out of it, so it's great for me to get as much time as possible in the car.
Paul's had a busy 92 season. He's had some impressive finishes. Now, how does he judge his performance?
It's funny that you mentioned that. It's really, I think it comes down to a situation where it's the same sort of thing in your love life. It's not necessarily getting what you want, but it's the thrill of the chase. And I set some pretty high goals for myself this year, wanted to run near the front or as close to the front as possible and perhaps make it to the podium. I haven't done that yet, but I've certainly been close enough to even frighten myself, and I'd certainly look to run near the front in the shootout.
Paul Duckworth, personable young man, not running in front today, though. In fact, in a fight for 14th right here, Pat.
Tony Morris right up alongside of Paul Duckworth as they run side by side up the Andretti straightaway into turn eight. Duckworth on the inside. Morris trying that outside pass. Will he get it? No. Duckworth will hold him off. So the great racing not only at the front, but really all the way through this some 40-car field here in the shootout. Duckworth holding on to 14th. Morris running 15th.
Boy, Tony got right up on the curbing there as we get back to our race leader. Here's Kenny Wilden, the Pringles Slick 50 man in front. There's, of course, Peter Cohen sitting in third spot. Right on, Peter. Look at that reigning champion, Rob Fellows. He wants to do something impressive. It has not been a great year. He'd love to have a great shootout today, Pat.
Well, Rob Fellows running in that fourth place position all over Peter Cohen.
20 laps are down. Five remain. Kenny Wilden leads. We'll be back. It's the Players Limited GM Motorsports Series on TSN. $150,000 overall shootout. We're into the key moments in this race. And look at this fight. Look at Rob Fellows make a move now, Pat.
Rob Fellows on the inside of Peter Cohen. They go side by side through turn two. Cohen right up alongside of Rob Fellows looking for third. Cohen just about right off the racetrack. Trevor Siebert looking to dive in on the inside, but no. Cohen will hold him off. Incredible race going on here for the last podium position in the shootout. Wilden, Spinard, and then comes this three-way fight going on for third. Rob Fellows currently holding down third. Peter Cohen and then Trevor Siebert in that white Camaro.
Oh, look out, Peter. Siebert has a look on the inside. No, he falls in right on the bumper again of Cohen. What will Siebert do, though, once they get out of corner 5, 5A, up onto the back straightaway, and look out. Siebert, I think, wants to try to make a move. No, he won't be able to do it here, Pat.
Kenny Wilden still leading. Spinard in second. Here's Rob Fellows, your third-place driver. Then Cohen, followed by the 33 car of Trevor Siebert. And right now, Jeff Lapcevich pretty much out of this race for third. Again, Cohen takes a look on the outside. No room to get around that number one car of Fellows. Siebert, 33, parked right there in fifth. And then Lapcevich, followed by the 79 car of Wade Lee. He still runs in the seventh place position. Outstanding, a three-driver race for third. All of those drivers using every inch of the racetrack. There's the last lap board being displayed at the flagger stand as they go down into turn one.
Whoops, they've got to do it now. Okay, they're into the final lap. We're a lot of money on the line in this shootout. Rob Fellows has gained some advantage here. He may make it to the podium. He's got Cohen back of him. Still young Jeff Lapcevich, of course, in striking distance. But here are the race leaders.
While this has been so much of the story in 1992 in the Players Limited GM Motorsport East Series, Kenny Wilden and Richard Spinard. Here is Wilden through turn four now for the final time under the bridge. Spinard in that second place position. Up into Moss Corner, there's slower cars ahead of Wilden and Spinard as they head out of turn 5B and up the back straightaway.
So Kenny Wilden has the advantage here. There is traffic, though, that could be of some concern as they come for that checkered flag. Kenny's going to have to be cool, but he can't be that cool. Not when you've got Richard right on your bumper. And now, for this third spot on the podium, is it going to be Rob Fellows? He's got Peter Cohen on him. Trevor Siebert in striking distance. Jeff Lapcevich and Wade Lee are not far away. And Cohen makes a move.
Peter Cohen right up to the outside of Rob Fellows as they crest the hill side by side. Fellows trying to hold on to third, and he does. Cohen will take another run at him. He tries to put a wheel on the inside as they go into turn number nine. There's Kenny Wilden out of turn 10. The checkered flag is out. Kenny Wilden wins the shootout.
What a year for Kenny Wilden. Oh, look at this. Rob Fellows. Oh, no. The rear of the car is, it's destroyed, Pat. He has gone into the guardrail. He's hit the concrete wall. What happened? Maybe we can get a replay. Ah, at least he gets to the checkered flag, so Rob finishes the race. Here's the replay.
While these two drivers battling for third as they come out of turn eight into nine, and oh, there was Cohen and Fellows getting into it in turn nine. It just looked as though Cohen tried to squeeze through on the inside. And there is the car of Rob Fellows parked after taking the checkered flag. But there is the big winner. Kenny Wilden celebrates.
There's our top five from the shootout. That completes our top 10. What a year it has been.
We just haven't gone wrong all year. And it's a nice way to end off the season. And it's nice to be, it's sad, but it's nice to be the last winner, last champion of the series. And hopefully we'll have another series going next year.
Well, Richard, you won the very first race in the series back in 86. You won the last one at Halifax. And you had another great run here at Motorsport.
Thank you. It was a pleasure. I'd like to thank Players Limited, GM Motorsport, Motomaster to support that series. It was the greatest series that I competed in.
So Kenny Wilden caps off just the magnificent 1992 Players Limited GM Motorsport series by winning the shootout, and will take home a $10,000 check for his efforts. For Pierre Oude and Jim Paulson, I'm Pat Gonzalez. We hope you've enjoyed the entire 1992 season. So long from Motorsport Park.
This has been the Players Limited GM Motorsport Series on TSN, brought to you by GM Motorsport and Players Limited.